Welcome to Blitzlytics Draft Recap Series, presented by Blitzlytics.com, where scouting meets analytics and you meet the newest crop of off-field talent. With me, as always, for all of this draft analysis is Blitzlytics Scouting Encyclopedia, a.k.a. the Director of Scouting, Mr. Roy Countryman. You recouped, you recovered. I know it was a long grind to get to this point.
Yeah, I had a good weekend here after the draft wrapped up on Saturday. Got to spend a day or so with my family. Get back acclimated into being a dad and a husband here, but ready to jump back in and see who stole the draft this year.
Yeah, you and me both, man. The job is not yet done. I know we've been grinding for months, pumping out scouting reports, pumping out as much draft analysis as possible. I got to give you a big props and shout out for finishing in the top 20 for the mock draft accuracy for mockdraftdatabase.com. You beat out some big, big names there, sir. You know, guys like Schrager and a few of those other elites that are in the industry that are getting paid millions of dollars to do this. So if anybody needs a new draft analyst, you know, I know a guy right here. Just saying.
Thanks, Jack. But, hey, I'm only as good as the people around me. So the whole scouting crew this year made it easy on me to really knock it out of the park. And we're just going to keep on growing this brand, you know?
Amen to that, sir. So without further ado, we're going to be covering the NFC North as our very first. We're going to go north, south, east, and west, and then we'll do the same thing for the AFC. After that, we're going to pit all these grades together, determine the division winners, and then we're going to have a little bracket style and determine the best team, whoever finishes on top. I think there's a few teams that stand out, but before we do that, let's get to this NFC North. I'm not sure if any of these guys are going to take the crown this year. A couple good drafts. Minnesota killed it, but we'll get to that here in just a second. The Chicago Bears are the first on the list as we go through alphabetical order, and you and me both have never been on this Cole Kmet train. We've wanted to derail this train for everyone for quite some time. He looks like he's running through water, through quicksand, through mud, whichever analogy you want to use. Super slow in and out of his breaks, terrible route runner. The inline blocking lacks effort. He's got the size. He's got the length. He's got the – I think when people look at Cole Kmet, they go, oh, look at that guy. But that's it. Like, if you actually watch the film, he's really not that good. I mean, he got a decent, you know, jump ball, like decent, but his athleticism isn't there. I don't know what guys are really seeing in him.
I think they really want him to be the next Mark Andrews, and he's just not that. He can jump ball situations, and that's about it for me. I don't want him in the open field. You touched upon his run blocking is not impressive to me at this point. He's nothing but average. He needs a lot of coaching. I know he didn't get a chance to absolutely get to play a lot because he focused on baseball as well in Notre Dame, from where he came from there for a second. But I just did not like that pick in the second round. Maybe in the fourth, fifth, yeah, you're taking a swing on upside, but not the second round.
Well, I mean, they just went and spent $10 million a year with a no-trade clause on Jimmy Graham. Why would you turn around and go with the highest pick you've had in 2 years and spend it on a tight end, which you know is not going to have year one production? And you've got 10 tight ends on your roster as is already. To me, this was just the biggest head scratcher. But moving on down the list, I mean, there is a few good picks. Like, they got a steal at pick 50 in the second round. Jalen Johnson we were very high on it as a cornerback out of Utah. Very aggressive. I like his approach. I know he's battled with a few injuries, and that's probably why he slipped. He could have been considered, you know, if he would have had a full healthy career, maybe we could have talked about him inside the top 10 or top 5. But we did have him, I think, in our superlatives, correct? Mm-hmm. There's some reasons to like about him if you want to elaborate on that.
Yeah, he's a press corner. He gets after the ball. His transitional skills are quite well for a big corner. He's aggressive. I think what really made him drop to the second round and kind of took him out of that, you know, round one discussion is he had I believe a labrum issue. He had an injury issue with his shoulders. It kind of took him out of that conversation right away. But he's an aggressive corner, and they needed help at corner, and that was probably their best pick, in my opinion, the whole way around. But he was a really fun guy to watch at Utah this past year. Took on the number one receivers, has that confidence, even if he's beat, to put it behind him and really, you know, pick up his play the rest of the game.
Yeah, I'm right there with you. So, I mean, we could talk about the rest of them. Travis Gibson out of Tulsa, Darnell Mooney, Arlington Hambright, and then Lacavius Simmons. Did I say that right?
Yep.
All right. Lacavius, yeah, you are Simmons. You are the expert. So again, I will revert back to Mr. Roy Countryman when it comes to these late round guys, especially these undrafted free agents. I know quite a few of them because some of our favorite guys went undrafted this year. I think a lot of it had to do with medicals. A lot of it had to do without being able to see these guys in person. But you know, some of these, it was just amazing to see how some of these guys fell. I feel terrible, but at the same time, it's a situation we're in with the COVID-19, and things happen. So best pick by far, Jalen Johnson. Worst pick by far, Cole Kmet. Why is Darnell Mooney the sleeper pick for you?
So Darnell Mooney, if you go back and watch him at Tulane, all he did was separate and make big plays. He's very hard to get continual coverage throughout the duration of the route. He's got good speed and quickness. He's somebody that just really can create separation with his route running. I was really impressed with that in his game tape. And I think he could have an Emmanuel Sanders-type career if he gains a little bit of bulk. He's just really, really lean. But he has the athleticism and the route running. He knows how to get open. And don't be surprised if he really endears himself to Nick Foles, who I think is going to be the starter this year, not Mr. Trubisky.
Yeah, I'm right there with you. I think it's going to be an easy competition for, you know, a Super Bowl winning quarterback to beat out Mitchell Trubisky come camp. In terms of wish they could have got, Jeff Gladney in the second. I mean, he went, pick 31 to the Minnesota Vikings. You know, they not get them, but now they have to play against them. They did get, like we said, they got Jalen Johnson, but I'm pretty sure they would have much rather had Jeff Gladney. I know we've had him ranked way, way higher. And I was glad to see after talking all that trash that he did get to go in the first round, because I was getting a little worried. But person that we can't believe they passed on, Jeremy Chinn. They definitely need help in the back end. So for them to pass on him and go grab Cole Kmet at 43 was completely asinine.
Yeah, I can't believe it, especially when you look at their depth chart now. They have Eddie Jackson, who is money. I mean, you can't complain at all with Eddie Jackson. But Deion Bush right now is their projected starter at safety. Not a lot of depth there, not a lot of talent. You know, you could have had Jeremy Chinn as more of the enforcer type role than maybe the ball hawk, being that that's where Eddie Jackson really, you know, excels at. I didn't understand them going with Kmet when they had 10 other tight ends on the roster, when you could have got a Jeremy Chinn, you know, play back air in the deep in the, you know, cover two with some of the corner play that they have that is lackluster.
Yeah, I'm right there with you. Who's this undrafted free agent for these guys to watch out for?
So the undrafted free agent to watch out for in Chicago, they didn't have a lot of them to pick from. So this one's going back to the family roots. It's Ladarius Mack. It's actually Khalil Mack's brother that they signed. And for him, he's just very energetic. He's not going to probably make the roster outside of maybe playing special teams, but he plays like his hair is on fire. You know, he might over pursue plays, but he's going to be one of them kamikazes that you would maybe see on special teams make the team here, you know, in week one.
That's awesome. There's a couple brothers now playing on the same team out here in the NFC North. So we'll move on down to that with the Detroit Lions. I mean, obviously they hit a home run with the third pick. It was kind of hard to mess that up. I don't know who they could have took to mess that pick up. Then they came back and they took DeAndre Swift, which was kind of a shocker. I did not peg them as a team that was going to go after a running back early. I think all of us kind of whiffed on that one. I know I had DeAndre Swift likely going to Miami, you know, maybe even my Bucks if he fell down that far. I knew he wasn't going to be the first running back off the board like most thought, but I didn't expect, I'll say this, I didn't expect KC to be taking Clyde Edwards-Helaire, and you and me were both stoked on that pick. I think nobody was more stoked than Ashton Moore, Blitzlytics, resident KC fan. You've guys seen on a couple of our draft podcasts and draft shows so far. Julian Arcuara, that was probably my favorite pick. I must say, I am very, very excited on that one. I think they got a steal in terms of overall value. They got a steal on that one. Jonah Jackson, the guard out of Ohio, kind of one-dimensional, but has room to develop and has a ton of traits. Logan Stenberger, Quinez, finish these off for me. You can actually pronounce some of these names.
Quintez Cephas from Wisconsin. He's a big-bodied receiver that's mostly going to be that big big slot guy. He doesn't have a lot of speed. He ran in the 4.7s. He plays like he's in the 4.7s as well. He's just a route runner. That's the only way he can make his catches is in contested situations. Jason Huntley, their other fifth-round pick, he's an explosive jitterbug, mostly going to be used on special teams. He had a lot of kick returns and punt returns at New Mexico State, some big plays there. Then we had him pick John Penasini from Utah, who was the running mate of Leki Fotu, and that was one of the reasons why Utah is so hard to run against. He is a nose tackle. He's a two-gapper, and he can show every once in a while, he can flash a quick first step and get in the backfield. But more than anything, he's that, you know, rotational run block it or run stuffing defensive tackle. And then Jason Cornell is just a guy that really he was a big time recruit. He was a 5-star recruit to Ohio State, but he never made his impact there. So they're taking a swing on upside and athleticism there with Mr. Cornell.
Yeah, so in terms of best pick, at least from a value standpoint, obviously Jeffrey Okuda is probably going to have a bigger impact. But if Julian Okwara can stay healthy while playing on the same field as his brother, which I'm very excited about. If you guys didn't get to see his draft video, it was pretty awesome. The whole room was excited trying to figure out where he was going, where they were, you know, who he was on the phone with. And they're asking his mom, and his mom is sitting next to him trying to look at the phone. She can't tell. And then, you know, he comes out and says that, you know, I'm going to be, I guess we get to roommate together. And he obviously had his brother in his room. And so they were pretty stoked. And that was just one of my highlight videos. Go for it and just read off the rest of these for me.
All right. So the worst pick for me was Quintez Cephas from Wisconsin. He's just somebody that I'm very not impressed with whenever I watch his tape. He can make the contested grab, and he plays just about slot only. He's just a big body guy. He's slow. He looks like a snail at times out in the field. I just do not like that pick. Especially in the fifth round, you could have got some other receivers there, a Freddie Swain from Florida that could have been a better pick. Just did not like that whatsoever. Then our sleeper pick, and that for me, it's a guy that's really been undervalued, Logan Stenberg, the guard from Kentucky. Right now they have Ode Bushi as one of their starting guards, and then Joe Dahl. They need some, you know, Rio Sherman up front, and I think you're going to see Jonah Jackson and Stenberg both get a chance to maybe, you know, win that right guard spot from them. I think Jackson's going to be their more, you know, versatile sixth offensive lineman where he can play center and guard. But Stenberg right there is a phone booth mauler. He has some tenacity and just attitude that he's going to inject into that offensive front. I think he's going to be a day one starter. I like Jackson's athleticism better, but when you're talking about a ballroom fighter, Logan Stenberg's your guy. Then wish they could have got. I think they were hoping that they could have grabbed Christian Fulton. And they wound up not being able to grab him. So that was one I thought they could have really used some more reinforcements opposite of Okuda now. They could have really grabbed Fulton, let him play, develop, and then let Denard, who's the guy from Atlanta, went there, the corner. Forgetting his name. Desmond Trufant.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, let him kind of go after this season in 1 year. The guy I can't believe they passed up on, being that Matt Patricia was in New England, watched Asante Samuel come up. If you could have stole Amik Robertson to play opposite of Jeffrey Okuda, that would have been nasty. That's attitude right there. You could have had two guys. Because then I think Patricia would have gave him the chance to stay outside, being they have Justin Coleman at nickel, who's one of the better nickels in all the NFL. Amik Robertson would have been a steal for them right there. I wish they would have made that pick, but Mayock got him before him.
Yeah, and one of our favorite guys that was on the top fives for our tight end group was Hunter Bryant. Injury concerns, correct, is the main reason why he fell. Overall, this was a stacked class for them. We gave them a B+. I love what they did. They arguably have one of the – you know, you're right. If they would have had Amik Robertson, we could have been talking about this as the best secondary in the league right now, at least from the cornerback standpoint, at least the most depth. And not to say that they still don't with Trufant and Okuda. That's a hell of a combination. They got better everywhere. They didn't, you know, they kind of spread it out on both the offense and defense side of the ball. And they definitely got some pieces there that are going to be able to help out on special teams. So B+, hands down, great draft for them. Most of the teams that we had here, you know, it's hard to knock them. They all had good drafts.
Yeah, there was a lot that made solid picks all over. You thought maybe they would maybe take a swing for some more upside, but it just seemed like this year more than any, they just stuck to their guns of who they thought their guys were, even though it might have been to their detriment in some teams.
Yeah, and for me, though, I'm going to say this is one of the few teams that I think had a bad draft, even though we loved, I think, pick 26 might have been our favorite. The fact that the Green Bay Packers decided they were going to move up and take Jordan Love, it makes absolutely no sense from a standpoint of, you know, win now mode, which they should be in. Obviously, they were in the NFC Championship last year. They really weren't in that. I mean, you could say they were there, but they weren't really there because they got manhandled, mauled, destroyed, dominated. They got their shit kicked in. Like, whatever term you want to use, they're nowhere even close to the Niners, even after this weekend. And they definitely did not help themselves. They didn't help themselves in free agency this year. You got to feel bad. You got to almost feel bad for Aaron Rodgers, but I personally don't, because I'm not a big Aaron Rodgers fan of the person, not the player. And I think Roy Kunchman is right there with me. So he took our boy, our favorite quarterback prospect, the quarterback who has the highest ceiling and is now going to get to sit behind Aaron Rodgers and learn from him, similar to that Brett Favre situation that Aaron Rodgers was in. So you'd think that Rodgers would be pretty okay with this and be understanding. But, I mean, he was just in the NFC Championship last year. Favre was coming off, I think, what, like a 4-12 season when this had happened, and that he had already been talking about retiring and so on and so forth. So there was a reason for them to go find Favre's replacement. I don't know if there's necessarily a reason for them to go find Aaron Rodgers' replacement. If I was that GM, I definitely would have been pushing to go get more help surround him, actually add a piece, add weapons. For the first time since Aaron Rodgers has been drafted, they took an offensive skill position, but it was to back Aaron Rodgers up, not to give him more pieces. So in a snarky way, I loved it. And from a GM and scouting perspective, I thought it was a terrible way to draft. Then after that, in the second round, they took A.J. Dillon. You already have two solid backs. You have arguably one of the best backs in the league in Aaron Jones. He was Blitzalytics MVP last year from our MVP metric due to the fact that his yards and his touchdowns equated to more wins than any other player in the league. So when he was scoring, they were winning. And when he wasn't scoring, that's when they were losing. So they go and grab A.J. Dillon, who is a pure power back. Somebody I like the highlights, but I just think that his footwork is a little sluggish. And when you have linebackers that are going to be ultra fast, ultra athletic, a lot more surefire tacklers than what you have in college, I just don't think his game's going to translate as well. I think he's a good goal line short yardage back, but he's not going to be a feature back. He's not going to be the guy who takes over if they decide they don't want to pay Aaron Jones.
Yeah, absolutely, Jack. I absolutely love the Jordan Love fit to Green Bay. I think for his long-term future and his upside, this was one of the two or three best places he could go to, because it's a similar situation as Patrick Mahomes. Patrick Mahomes sat behind a veteran like Alex Smith for a year, got to learn the system, got to learn what they expected out of him, and help, you know, take the rough edges off. Because Jordan Love does have some rough edges, we know that. But the athletic profile and his traits that he has you cannot teach are there. And a similar quarterback to him, athletically wise and passing, you know, off platform, is Aaron Rodgers. I'm with you. I don't like Aaron Rodgers the person, but Aaron Rodgers the quarterback and Jordan Love, there's a lot of similarities to that skill set. Jordan Love can make a lot of the throws that Aaron Rodgers can, that everybody always talks up his arm talent as one of the five best all time. Jordan Love is up there. He can make them, you know, awe-inspiring throws. But outside of that, I get why you would trade up to go get your guy if you think for the next 10, 15 years that's going to be your starter. Great. But you can't back that up with a pick then like an A.J. Dillon, whenever you could have went out and got a couple receivers or a tight end that could come in day one and kind of smooth over the relationship with Rodgers. I think that's where they kind of missed the boat. I think they were trying to approach this as, we're going to get an attitude on offense now, to where we're going to have a two-headed running monster, where you have Aaron Jones, who runs with a lot of attitude himself, quickness, power, strength, pass-catching ability. He's everything you want in the back. A.J. Dillon is nothing more than a plodding power back, and I'm sorry, that's yesteryear-type football in this day and age. You're behind the times. Unless you're a Tennessee Titans, who have one of the most dominant backs in the league, A.J. Dillon is not Derrick Henry.
Yeah, he doesn't run. He doesn't have the same 40 time as Derrick Henry, not even close.
He's not that type of freak athlete. You could, in my opinion, you could have you could have took him in the third round and you would have been a lot happier if you would have got a pass catcher here of some sort in the second round.
Yeah. We'll just kind of skip through and go straight to the superlatives. Best pick, obviously, Jordan Love. Worst pick, A.J. Dillon. Go through the rest of these for me.
So the sleeper pick that we decided on was Josiah DeGuara, and he was a part of my top five tight end series. I absolutely love this guy's versatility. He's a great pass catcher, can fit as a blocker out in space from fullback. He can get down the field as a seam stretcher. He can break tackles after the catch. Great fluidity. Just love this all-around talent, and I think Aaron Rodgers is going to utilize him in year one. We're going to see him a lot of different packages that we're going to see him really his pass catching ability flourish. So I think that was a steal in the third round. But if they could have just took another pass catcher in the second, I think everybody in Green Bay would have been a little bit happier.
Yeah. Like you put on the list, Bryan Edwards or Devin Duvernay. Duvernay was one of my favorites. You know, just him inside the slot would have been nasty. And then coming out of the backfield on pass catching downs, they could have done a lot with them. I mean, it would have helped Aaron Rodgers. I feel like this franchise just thinks that they can rely on his arm talent and that's it. And he's going to get it done just like, you know, how Tom Brady was able to get it done with lesser known guys. But they were still pumping in players year after year into the offense. And they're just not doing that here.
Well, I can see they have a lot of young guys, but they're all the same similar skill set.
Yeah.
Equanimee St. Brown, Marquez Valdez-Scantling, Alan Lazard. They're all big bodied, either speed or power types. Whereas a Duvernay would have been a more speed aspect in the slot, like you said. They have Devontae Adams. It would have just been a differing skill set. I think that's really where they missed the boat. That was two players exactly like you said, Jack. Wish they could have got. The guy I can't believe they passed up was a defender in the second round. Just going to the opposite side of the ball instead of taking a power runner. They need some help at safety. They got Adrian Amos. I think Darnell Savage is more of a versatile guy that you want to let play down more in the nickel situations. Jeremy Chinn would look great in Green Bay being back there. They've had issues at linebacker as well. He could have played a lot of sub package linebacker with Christian Kirksey and the nickel. I think that would have just gave them a little bit more versatility on defense. And I can't believe they passed him up for a plodding power back.
Right there with you on that one. Made no sense.
For me, the undrafted free agent to watch was a guy I highlighted on my East-West Shrine Game, or excuse me, NFLPA Collegiate Bowl preview. It's Will Sunderland from Troy. He played corner and safety wise there. He's huge. He's 6'4". He played safety this year. He played corner and safety. He has length, speed, strength, and he can shut down people. If you have a chess piece, maybe this is the guy they got. You know, they targeted. They knew they were going to get an undrafted free agency that might be able to pick up that role I was just saying about with a Jeremy Chinn, where he can be, you know, take on tight ends, be an outside cover guy, you know, be a nickel and dime sub package type player.
Yeah, overall, we gave him a grade of a final grade of B. I think that has a lot to do because we just love Jordan Love. Without that pick, I think it would have been in the C range. I think most of these grades are going to be a lot higher. I mean, I've given F grades and D's and you know, C minuses, but it's kind of hard to do in this draft class because there's just so much good talent. It was really hard to mess up a draft. I think the Green Bay Packers were one of the few teams that technically did it, but even then, they still got some solid pieces in rounds 1 through 7.
Yeah, that's definitely based on the upside of Jordan Love. If you take Jordan Love out of there and even a different pick than Josiah DeGuara for me, this is in the F range. Because a lot of their linemen they took were great college players, but they're not going to be nothing more than depth. And they addressed the offensive line last year. I mean, they got Elgington Jenkins that played a lot of snaps, and they've invested a lot in that offensive line. So even a couple of them later picks that they invested in that offensive line, I think they could have took a chance on a pass catcher, even with one of them instead of taking – you know, two or three guard center types.
Yeah. Now, if we wanted to go polar opposites in terms of draft and how we value, the Vikings hit a absolute freaking home run. They made the draft board theirs. They moved up and down. They collected picks. Another pick for next year, another first round pick for next year. They did a lot with very little, or not, they did a lot with a lot. Let me rephrase that. But they took the right guys at the right time. I think in terms of value-based drafting, it was spot on. In terms of taking taking steals where you can get them. It was spot on. Finding depth, finding guys that you can mold, you know, like a guy like a Josh Metellus, who we think is, you know, is an amazing tackler, but very, very raw in terms of pass coverage, especially a man. We watched him get eaten up, but class act guy, somebody who if you can develop into has a huge potential, but was just, again, just extremely raw. But just going down the list really quick, Justin Jefferson was a first round guy for us. Jeff Gladney was a first round guy for us. Ezra Cleveland was somebody who we talked about having in the first round. I think we had him at a second round grade, or at least on our big board rankings, had him in the second round as a somebody who can definitely develop into a, you know, day one starter in the NFL. Cam Dantzler was one of my favorite cornerbacks, one of the few people who shut down Jamar Chase. Go through the list for me.
Yeah, really. You said, Jack, they hit home run after home run. DJ Wonnum is a versatile pass rusher from South Carolina. He can stand up, put his hand in the dirt. He can play three technique all the way out. James Lynch is one of my favorite guys. He's not a pure athlete, but man, you're not going to find somebody with more energy and attitude with his hand fighting. He's going to be somebody day one's going to be an interior pass rusher in a rotation there. It's going to be able to contribute. Troy Dye, athletic, you know, defender at linebacker. He runs sideline to sideline. Gritty toughness. He played with a broken hand this past year and actually played quite well. Harrison Hand is a former Baylor corner who followed his coach to Temple. Great athleticism and attitude. He's not afraid to come up and hit some guys in the mouth. So that's a Mike Zimmer pick right there. He's somebody that's going to be able to be molded and shaped to the guy they want. It's going to fit that press man system. KJ Osborne's a good pass catcher. Randall's the same way. He was a left tackle at Oregon State. Not sure he's going to be able to stay there in the pros. He's probably going to have to move inside the guard. Metellus was one of my favorites. You already touched upon him. He's going to fit, you know, a lot of different roles, special teams ace. He can play linebacker and sub package, and also, you know, some strong safety if you want to ask of him. Kenny Willekes in the seventh round is a steal. He doesn't have great measurables, but man, you can't outweigh his heart. He's going to be somebody that's going to be in this rotation of pass rushers. He's going to get to the quarterback and get there often just because of his advanced hand fighting. Nate Stanley, not a big fan of him. I think he should have been an undrafted free agent, but I get it. They want to develop a guy behind Kirk Cousins. Brian Cole, big bodied safety, played some corner. He can play a little bit here and there. Is going to be a guy that's going to be probably taking on that J-Ron Curse role, more of a special teams guy. Kyle Hinton is an athletic guard from Washburn, is probably going to have to be on the practice squad for a year or two to add some more strength.
So in terms of our best pick, I think Cam Dantzler in terms of value. Again, this is somebody who is sneaky good, a little bit undersized, could definitely add some weight to him and kind of fill out that. He's still got a young man's body. He's very, very lean, but it's not for – I mean, he doesn't lack effort. He has tremendous ball skills, and he is a hell of a coverage corner. Tackling can be susceptible at times. But, I mean, it's not for lack of effort. It's not like he's backpedaling like a Josh Jackson. He's trying. He's just kind of, like I said, he's undersized. Worst pick, I'm right there with you, Nate Stanley, and we can kind of jump into this because this is the wish they could have got was Anthony Gordon. I think they should have swapped those picks. The fact that Anthony Gordon went undrafted was asinine. It was, you know, blasphemy, as they say. It was just idiotic. We know what kind of quarterback he's going to be. So now that he went to Seattle. Yep. I feel bad that he's not going to have any chance to start. But, you know, he might be one of those guys that can learn behind Russell Wilson, and then, you know, maybe get a chance elsewhere in a few years after he's you know, gone through the ringer and gone through the, you know, learned under one of the greatest, you know, quarterbacks in the league. In terms of sleeper pick, you had Harrison Hand. You talked about him a little bit. Undrafted free agent to watch, or before we go there, can't believe they passed on Nitay Muti. I think that was a great one. I think he could have been a run lane opener big time for the Minnesota Vikings. He kind of fits that play style that they have, the in between the tackles running for Dalvin Cook. If he can stay healthy, he is one of the best interiors, just because we had him ranked lower And his grade was kind of susceptible for us. I think we had a third or a third round grade on him. I had done the report, and insane physical strength. But, you know, and barely ever, I think he only gave up four pressures in his career. I barely even seen him give up a pressure, and I watched several games. He manhandled Ed Oliver. He destroyed Daron Payne back in 2017. You know, guys that are considered first-round prospects and that are having major success in the NFL, he had his way from a physical standpoint. So if he can stay healthy, he could certainly be one of the steals of this draft. He would have been a perfect fit over Blake Brandel. Undrafted free agent to watch, feel free, chime me in, because again, you are the scouting expert. Some of these guys I do not know.
So you were just hitting the nail on the head there. I would have loved to see Nite Muti pulling for Dalvin Cook in that system. That would have been nasty, especially over Blake Brandel. You know, he's a technician more than anything. He lacks length and foot quickness, but Muti would have just been somebody I would have took a chance on. Even at this, I mean, you're losing a sixth round pick there at that point, even if he doesn't, you know, pan out anyway with injuries, at least you took a swing on that athletic profile and that upside. But you know, maybe Brandel will prove me wrong and he'll be a 10-year starter, but I'd highly doubt that. Courtney Davis is a guy that played at Texas A&M. He was kind of overshadowed by Kendrick Rogers, but man, this guy, he can get open. If you haven't watched it yet, go to the Footwork King. He's been working with him. You can see the type of athleticism this guy has, the quickness, the ability to get open on his route running. He just reminds me as a poor man, Stephon Diggs. They really outbid the Cowboys here to really grab Courtney Davis in undrafted free agency. And I would not be surprised if he makes the roster after losing a Diggs. You know, they need to replace them snaps. And right now you have a Justin Jefferson and Thielen, but outside of that, you have Tajay Sharp coming over from the Tennessee Titans and maybe Chad Beebe. I really think Courtney Davis can maybe even beat out one of their fifth-round picks here in Osborne. I just like his upside a little more than Osborne.
Yeah, they've been able to find guys off the street and undrafted free agents and fill roles. I mean, that's what Adam Thielen was. I mean, came off the street, correct?
Yep.
Right? Yeah, he came off the street.
Minnesota State, I believe.
Yeah, and they found guys like, you know, Morris Borzinger, like super raw prospects off the street. I mean, they can keep doing it and just filling holes on the offense side of the ball. But, yeah, it's going to be interesting. I'm really excited to see what Justin Jefferson does filling in for Stephon Diggs. I think that was the perfect fit. I think that's who we both mocked, I believe. I think we both mocked them to him. And so between Justin Jefferson, Jeff Gladney, Cam Dantzler, Troy Dye, I think this was a home run draft class, A++ if we could give it. But yeah, this is going to be in the running for one of the best there is. So that concludes all four, correct? Yep. We went through all four. Thank you guys for tuning in. Stay tuned for more. This is unanimous, correct? It's got to be. Minnesota wins this division. It's not even close. We don't even have to debate the topic.
Nope, Minnesota for the FTW, they really stole with that many picks, and they hit home runs on at least 2/3 of them.
All right, Blitz out.